and welcome to Collider Movie Talk for movie fans. I'm your host, Natasha Martinez, and this is the daily show where we give you all the latest news in the world of movies, plus some insight into what it all means. Kicking off our awesome panel today is John Campea.
Well, greetings and salutations, everybody. Welcome to the best damn movie-related show on the planet Earth, coming to you from right here at the Collider Video Studios here in Burbank, California. My last chance to say pre-celebration for the Pats victory this weekend. Go Brady.
And joining us on today's show, our special guest, Michael Rapaport.
He's back!
He needs back. No introduction. The man himself, the monologuer of monologuers.
You're allowed to insult the Patriots. It's fine.
Yes. Yeah. Well, it's hard to insult them because they're very
good. It's been nice having Michael Rapaport here. Maybe he can come back again next time.
He said they were good. No, they're good. They're good. That doesn't mean you have to like them.
Also joining us, Jeremy Jahns.
That's credit where credit's due. I like that. Now, yeah, I'm sitting right next to Michael Rapaport, which means I'm going to laugh a lot and say very little. It's going to be a lot of fun.
And rounding off our panel, Kristian Harloff.
Well, I know it's going to happen, so I'm going to be the first to do it. Fuck it.
All right, well, as some of you guys may know, there have been a couple of major trailers dropped this morning that a lot of people in the fan community have been looking forward to them. And Natasha, kick us off.
Okay, 20th Century Fox has released the final Logan trailer online. The story of Hugh Jackman's last outing as Wolverine has been the driving force behind the highly anticipated film. And with this final trailer, it looks like fans will be getting a proper send-off. Not long now as we await Logan to hit theaters on March 3rd, 2017. John, what did you think about the final trailer for Logan?
Okay, well, let's put that, Hugh Jackman's, in quotes, final appearance as Wolverine, until he puts out a picture with Ryan Reynolds yesterday, pretty much telegraphing that he's going to be in Deadpool 2, but be that as it may. Look, the first Logan trailer, hands down, no questions asked, nothing else came close. The first Logan trailer with that great Johnny Cash soundtrack over top of it was the best trailer of 2016. I mean, that damn thing was art. I've watched that thing like 50, 60, 70 times. This trailer is also very good. It's very good. But I would have gone nuts and lost my mind for it had it not been for that stupid little shot of them reading X-Men comics. Like, to me, that was something you'd put in Deadpool. It did not fit for me with the tone and everything they had from the first trailer or the rest of this trailer. Now, take that out of it for a second. It was only about an 8-second shot. It's a great trailer. It's really a great trailer, and you get a sense of just how feral it looks like the little girl is indeed X-23. Now, is it just me? Was that not Taylor Johnson?
No, I think it's the guy that looked like
him. It looked a hell of a lot like him. Okay, I'll let that one go. But it's a good trailer. It was visceral. It had a lot of energy to it. It looked great. I'm looking forward to seeing it. Jeremy, what about you?
Well, I would argue that if Logan's going to be in the next Deadpool, as you say, then it's part of the same universe. Ergo, they're allowed to break the fourth wall with the X-Men comics. That would be my argument to John Campea. My argument to the world is I like it because all this shit that's happened, I mean, there's destruction, there's mayhem, there's apocalypse killing everything. In this world of marketing and consumerism, they're going to be like, how do we turn that into comic books? Let's make an X-Men comic book. So I imagine there would be X-Men comic books. I actually thought it was pretty cool in the fact that I think it has an opportunity to separate the comic books from this movie, because this movie looks like it doesn't look like X-Men. It looks like its own. It looks like The Last of Us, and Ellie in The Last of Us was a huge comic book fan, so
that's
it's
true.
More Last of Us than ever. So I actually thought that X-Men comic books existing in the Logan movie was actually kind of a neat little thing.
Michael, you just had a chance to watch it for the first time with us. What did you make of it?
I thought it was a good trailer. Now, as you may or may not know, I don't know who Logan is. I don't know all the details of what you're talking about with the comic book, not comic book, the Deadpool. I don't know the history and the origin. The Logan's a little girl.
Logan Wolverine. Is Wolverine. That's his other name.
His real name.
Wolverine.
You're like, he's Wolverine. Like, you don't know that? No, I don't know
really?
That. Logan was the little girl.
In my defense, I've never met a human being who didn't know who Wolverine was.
Well,
that's
you're
awesome.
Living in
you're
a small little
you're
niche,
ground.
You know, like, you know, in a sci-fi world.
I call it my echo chamber.
We walk
me
on
and
the street. And I go, yo, you know who Logan is? And they're going to be like, I don't know who the hell Logan is.
I feel like we should do that. We should go there and be like, do you know who Logan is?
Yeah, and we'll see like, yeah, now if we go to one of your little comic book conventions, everybody's going to know who Logan
we'll
is.
Just go anywhere,
but I'm just saying, like, we'll walk down the street somewhere and say, do you know who Logan is? I bet you a lot of people won't know who the hell Logan is. I'm not just like, on this show, I'm in the minority. And it's like, what, you don't know who Logan is? No, I don't know Logan. I thought the Logan was the little girl. So who's the little girl?
Our assumption is there's a character from the comic book world known as X-23, who in some incarnations of the comic book is actually a genetic reproduction of Logan, if I'm not mistaken. Like, what she's going to be in the movie.
The claws.
Why don't they just call Logan Wolverine? That's his real name is Logan?
His real name is Logan.
His real name is Logan.
His hero name is Wolverine.
Right. He's a real name, and then he's got a hero thing, and he's trying to resist his thing for kicking ass and scratching people's eyes out now, right?
Yeah. Right, right.
But just far as me as the layman,
right,
straight up, because, you know, I'm not bullshitting you. I don't know anything about this world. Just to watch that trailer, I thought it looked interesting. I thought that little girl looked good, and I thought it looked like one of these more genuinely accessible, story-based Marvel films.
Right.
Which, for me, the guy who's not, into all the details and minutiae of it, made it look like I would go see that film. So when you ask me about the trailer, which was the original question, and how we got to this, I say it looked like a good trailer. And the little girl looked good. And, of course, what's my man's name?
Patrick Stewart or Hugh Jackman?
Hugh Jackman. And, of course, Patrick Stewart looked good. And I liked seeing him sort of scale down. And I don't know what that character is, but it looked good.
Nice. That's the trick right there.
Because it really is.
Now, when you look at majority, and we've certainly heard Michael's opinions on some of the bigger blockbusters, when you can get someone who doesn't know the lore, and you, because the trailer is absolutely more grounded.
Mm-hmm.
It seems more like, if you didn't know at first when you started watching that, I'm curious to where you see it, and you didn't really maybe even know it was a superhero movie at first, because it's shot in a way that it looks like it could be another Hell or High Water or something along those lines.
But it looks like it was made by the producers of Hell or High Water.
Right, so then the claws come out, and you see it. I actually really did like the comic book scene a lot. I'm with Jeremy on this one, because I think that it's like this lore of the X-Men, and it's almost like it's like myth, and Wolverine or Logan even says as much in the thing. He's like, this is how they see us. Some of that stuff didn't really happen that way, but fine, it's like the old fairy tales. And it's interesting where this world is taking place. What I liked about this trailer, like every other trailer that you get that first initial teaser, then you get this one, there's more story to this. We know exactly what we know, that it's like these three amigos now are kind of on the run, and they're really protecting this girl. And when Logan does the leap in the forest, and then the girl does the leap, mm-hmm. I was like, yeah, I'm in. So I was worried, because I didn't know what that scene was you were talking about. There was one moment. I actually loved this trailer. I thought it was great.
I think the one thing that really stands out to me about it is that they are going for a particular tone in this thing that we suspected from the first trailer, but a lot of that came from the Johnny Cash music.
Sure.
It becomes clear they are going with that tone. This is going to be a lot more gritty, a lot darker. It sounds like it's the Wolverine film that Hugh Jackman always wanted to do. This is the film that he always wanted to do from the beginning. And so it's a great trailer. Again, I hate the little comic book fourth wall breaking nonsense. That aside, I thought the trailer was great, and I'm really looking forward to Logan. Now, on top of that, another trailer dropped that there are a lot of people, for a film that a lot of people are looking forward to, not me necessarily, and that's new Nick Saban's Power Rangers. Of course, not Nick Saban. Saban's Power Rangers is coming out. I've said from the beginning I thought this movie was a waste of time. I saw the first trailer. I thought it was actually really pretty good, I have to admit it. This trailer came out, and I think this is a trailer that is going to appeal more to the fans of the original TV series. Because one of the things I noticed, even though that first trailer I thought was pretty good, it's funny because I found a lot of the hardcore fans of the original Power Rangers stuff were kind of turned off by it. Then I watched this trailer this morning, and I said to Wendy before she saw it, I said, I think this is one you're going to like more. I think this is one that traditional fans of Power Rangers are going to appreciate more. Anyway, Kristian, you saw it. What did you think about it?
It's funny you say that, because before the first trailer, I didn't care about this movie. I think that it should be made for the fans, obviously, but I didn't have any interest in it. The first trailer comes, and I was like, well, wait a minute. I actually can get on board with this thing, because it looked more like Chronicle than anything else. This one, to me, didn't really work the same way. I think that more like traditional Power Rangers fans might really like it, because, like you said, I think that it goes back into that feeling, the positive is that it's not going away from brand. It's kind of sticking with what made the brand popular. But I think that it went a little bit more on the kid side to me. It doesn't mean it's going to be a bad movie. It just went away from my interest. So I thought it was fine.
Jeremy.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. The first trailer, I agree. It had that almost, I mean, you know, it's not going to be like Chronicle, for God's sakes.
Or Logan.
Right. Nothing like that. But the trailer, I thought, was good in making it, having a lot of intrigue in it. This one reminded me of the movie they came out with in the mid-90s. Now, compared to the show, one of the gripes I always had about that movie, even when I saw it when I was young, was the fact that they go through all this training and they finally become Power Rangers in the last quarter of the movie, and then we actually see some Power Ranger stuff. This looks like they're going to train for a long time, and then that happens. I don't want that to happen. It does address the fact that it's like, are they just powerful only with their suits, or are they powerful when they're just human beings? So now we know it's like, oh, they're like Spider-Man punching their sinks and wrecking their utilities. So, but there is a lot more. I think we see Goldar in a scene. There's more. We saw a little more of the Zords. There's also a big destruction mayhem. And I thought it looked a little cheesier than the first trailer. And then I realized it's based on Power Rangers, which is arguably the cheesiest fun show that I've ever liked. So, yeah, I mean, that's where I stand on it. I prefer the first trailer to the second one, but we'll see how the movie is. I hope it crushes.
So, Michael, I'm just curious. As somebody as well-versed in the history and lore of the Power Rangers
yeah. You're the man.
You, how did this trailer strike you?
I personally, I don't fuck with the Power Rangers.
You know what's funny? This whole time, I was like, he hasn't said fuck once, and it's been freaking me out.
That's a perfect way to use it. I don't fuck with the Power Rangers.
That's a new T-shirt.
It's like
right
some, it's like some Ninja Turtle shit to me. Like, they got the red one and the blue one and all that. Like, I don't take the Power Rangers seriously. And for me, listen, you know, I say this every time I talk about a film. You know, I want everybody to succeed, and I want all the actors in it to have, get success from it. I want the movie to be successful. But speaking for me, when I see that trailer, I checked out right away because I don't know all this subtext and this side text, and I don't think it's fair to assume that everybody does, whether you're a grown up or a kid. So for me, like, that trailer didn't. I wasn't interested at all. And like the Logan trailer, like we've proven, I didn't know the context of it all, but I was like, okay, this is interesting. And one of the things that also, when you brought up what it reminded me of, it also, because it had the little girl, reminded me a little bit of The Professional.
Leon. I think it was great. All right, what's next?
Okay, during a presentation by Sony Pictures Animation for their upcoming film Slate, details for their Untitled Animated Spider-Man Project were finally revealed. In addition to the confirmation that the project would be a standalone feature, it's now official. Miles Morales is coming to the big screen. Written by Phil Lord and executive produced by Lord and Chris Miller, the Miles Morales-led Spidey film will be directed by The Little Princes, Bob Persichetti, and Rise of the Guardians, Peter Ramsey, with a release date set for December 21st, 2018. Jeremy, are you excited about the Spidey animated film led by Miles Morales?
Yeah, I think that's good. I'm over here laughing my ass off at the fact that every time we have Michael Rapaport on, we talk about Spider-Man. I don't know why. I just like the last time you were here, we talked about Spider-Man. Right. And we're like, we're going to talk about some new shit today. So here's Spider-Man.
But how many times a week do you talk about Spider-Man? Like, how many times
maybe
do you guys talk
maybe
about
twice
Spider-Man?
A week.
There's a couple Spider-Man stories.
As we gear up to the movie.
Yeah, now, who's Miles Morales?
So Miles Morales is Peter Parker was always Spider-Man. He's Spider-Man for ever. And then at a point in the 2000-somethings, they were like, hey, we need to have another Spider-Man, so they made Miles Morales.
Is it Puerto Rican?
I believe so.
Yeah, actually,
for real? So Spider-Man's Puerto Rican?
Yeah. So add some diversity to the Spider-Man thing, you know? And which is interesting
Hold up. So is Spider-Man Peter Parker, or is Spider-Man Miles Morales?
Okay, so in this alternate kind of...
I was going to geek out, but you could do it.
In this alternate kind of thing, there was a thing where Peter Parker died. Correct me where I'm wrong. Peter Parker died.
Tobey Maguire.
Yes, Tobey Maguire dies. And then what happens is Andrew Garfield finds his rotting corpse. No, so he dies, Peter Parker dies, and Miles Morales takes up the mantle of Spider-Man, if you will. I cannot remember how he gets
his powers.
And
Miles Morales
is
like a regular Joe Schmo.
Just regular kid, just a younger kid.
Who played this part?
This has never been in the movies. This has never been
in the
movies.
Comics.
It's only been in the comics before. This is a first. This will be the first time in a movie that a Miles Morales Spider-Man is going to be.
So who's
going
to play this part in the movie?
It's animated.
It's animated.
But I don't know who's going to be the voice.
It's going to be an animated film, but being produced.
That's racism, man.
Being produced.
Why they don't get a real guy to do it?
I found that interesting. I was like, so Miles Morales is not going to get a live action movie, but he's going to be animated.
I think this is. Cause remember, there's been a lot of fans that have talked about. Maybe they could do Miles Morales. Maybe they could do Miles Morales. And the big argument against it, I think, is the same thing why you don't do Batman Beyond. To the general public, Batman is Bruce Wayne. Mm-hmm. And I think to the general public, Spider-Man is Peter Parker. And I think with Lord and Miller, the guys behind 21 Jump Street, 22 Jump Street, the Lego movie, and the upcoming Han Solo movie, I think in a way, by using an animated film, I think this is a way for Marvel to kind of test the water a little bit to see, would the general movie-going audience be open to a Spider-Man that isn't Peter Parker? If they're not, okay, it was just an animated movie. If they are, then that could expand the universe for them a lot later on in live action.
Well, I also think it's important to what they're doing here. Actually, this is pretty smart to do it this way, because you can't do Miles Morales yet, because we just got this kid.
A brand new Peter Parker.
Exactly. No,
now, if the response to this animated film shows how much that Miles Morales has become popular, I think it opens up the doorway in a few years. Once you've done those two or three Spider-Man movies with, I was going to say Cody Hall.
Cody Hall.
Once you set that up and you put a couple animated movies out, then it's a good transition, I think, to get Miles Morales in live action.
But the Miles Morales character, he's just a regular guy, and then at night when the freaks come out, he becomes Spider-Man,
right? How did he get his powers, though? See, I don't know enough about Miles Morales.
Yeah, I'm going to have a big
question. He does have Spider-Man powers.
Yeah, he has Spider-Man powers. I mean, I'm going
to
say...
So at the end of the day, you want to see him be Spider-Man.
Right.
Yes.
That's what you go to see. So I don't think, like, as far as what people will buy, I don't think people give a shit. That's just me.
Well, that's what they're betting on.
Yeah, I don't think they should care. It's like it's just a different Joe Schmo. I'm sure it's not going to, be like, they're not going to cast like Al Pacino from Carlito's Way and then he turns into Miles Morales, and then he turns into Spider-Man. It's not like, so I'm sure it'll, just be like a regular Joe Schmo and then he's Spider-Man.
Yeah, I think it's Kristian hit the nail on the head, because they have this new Spider-Man movie coming out with this new kid. They don't want to detract the spotlight from that guy. So they're like, we're going to use him as much as we can, and then maybe later on.
Damn, my web shooters.
Right. Yes. Ha!
But there are two things they're taking risks on here, right? There are two things they're trying out. Number one is a Miles Morales character. But the second thing they're doing is this. Since I think Batman Mask of the Phantasm, don't think there's been a major release animated superhero other than Big Hero 6.
Joke? Did that come out in
Wide they, release? They like put that a in a theater. Couple of theaters. Okay. I mean, that was not the same. This is going to be a wide release, major motion picture film with a major comic book character as the head in animated format. And they have not done that since, damn it, when did Mask of the Phantasm come out? Like
93? No, mid-90s.
Was it mid-90s, something like that?
It was somewhere in the 90s.
So it's been a while. So they're rolling the dice on two things. Can an animated movie universe work? And then on top of that, will the general movie-going audience accept a Miles Morales? I think these are two questions that can be really interesting to see how these play out. All right, guys, it is Thursday, which means it's time for us to talk about what is opening this week, brought to you by our friends at AMC Theaters. Natasha, what is opening this week?
All right, well, a movie I'm excited to watch, Split. After three girls are kidnapped by a man with 24 distinct personalities, they must find some of the different personalities that can help them while running away and staying alive from the others. The Founder is also opening this week, the true story of how Ray Kroc, played by Michael Keaton, a struggling salesman from Illinois, met Mac, played by John Carroll Lynch, and Dick McDonald, played by Nick Offerman, who were running a burger operation in 1950 Southern California. Kroc soon maneuvers himself into a position to be able to pull the company from the brothers and create a multi-billion dollar empire. And Triple X, the return of Xander Cage. After coming out of self-imposed exile, daredevil operative Xander Cage, played by Vin Diesel, must race against time to recover a sinister weapon known as Pandora's Box, a device that controls every military satellite in the world.
Come on, when that last picture came up, we all thought, I'm one of the force of forces, me, right?
Totally.
I mean, come on, we all thought it. All right, so Jeremy, let's start with you. Split, The Founder, and Triple X, which one should people be most excited about going to see this weekend?
I would say Split, because Michael Rapaport and I were talking before this show, you haven't seen Split, right?
Nope.
Yeah. All right, so
I didn't get invited to the screening you guys went to.
That's bullshit. See, I'd have taken it. You'd have been my plus one.
Come on, man.
Next time, I'm telling you. But Split is M. Night Shyamalan used to make good movies, and then he somehow took a dive into madness. And then I enjoyed his last movie, which was The Visit, and then I enjoyed
Split.
Yes,
which was a nice little film.
Right, and so, I mean, that's two that where you're looking at it, you're like, oh, this is harkening back to his early days of filmmaking when he was in his stride, when this guy was going to take over the world. I'm hoping that Shyamalan is like the great comeback director story of Hollywood in recent time, and I think people should go see Split, especially if you're someone who was like, oh, I used to like Shyamalan movies, but I don't anymore. he should make his older stuff. He should make movies like that. He has. He listened to you. So I feel like if you had that gripe before, you should go see Split to support that. To support that decision that he made. So Split, for sure.
I tell you, the one I'm looking forward to the most out of these three, and I have not seen any of these three yet. I have not seen, I heard all about Split, I heard all about a lot of, but the one I'm looking forward to the most, I've been dying to see this movie since they first announced it, Michael Keaton and the Founder. I mean, I'm just dying to see this film. So when, especially when you look at not just Michael Keaton and the Michael Keaton songs that he's going through, but like you got Nick Offerman in there as well. It's a strong cast around based on the true story of how McDonald's came to be. It's got a little bit of a flavor of that, of the Social Network in there at the same time. That's the one I'm really looking forward to. So, Michael, let me ask you this. Split, The Founder, and XXX. You could only go see one movie this weekend. What's the one you're going to go see?
The Founder. Nice. I'd definitely go see The Founder. Now, what concerns me about that, this film, is because this to me feels like it could be a potential Oscar film. But when good, dramatic, sort of dark comedies like this come out in January, I go, why didn't they release this in November or December? What is wrong with this film that it wasn't worthy? Because to like this, Oscar films are no longer released in January. Dark, you know, sort of dramas, high level, are not released in January. They're released October, November, December. So to me, I'm curious as to why they didn't release it in at that time, and they're releasing it in January as a holdover because it's no longer. And Michael Keaton is so award friendly now, and of course the awards, so, you know, push forward, you know, business to the box office and all that stuff. So that's my only concern. But I did like the trailer, and I love Michael Keaton. I love his sort of resurgence.
The one thing is, I do believe they did release The Founder in enough theaters in late December to qualify it for the Oscar.
But no Oscar buzz, no gold.
No, there's no buzz.
There hasn't been enough buzz. I've seen all three of these movies.
You saw them already?
I've seen all three.
What, so, screenings?
Screeners and screenings,
well,
yes.
Well, again, so. What am I? Am I fucking chopped liver over
here?
Well, maybe if you were on Movie Talk a little bit more, some people might take you seriously.
You're a Giants fan.
I'm a Giants fan.
So you come with me next time. Don't worry about the Patriots fan. Screw this guy. So what I would say with all three is, and take that concern away from you. You look at a movie like A Monster Calls, which does have an Oscar buzz, and that came out in January wide release, also had a limited release. You've got the Live by Night movie you were talking about, the Ben Affleck, even though not the best movie, still was going to go for Oscar buzz, limited release. When The Revenant came out and won all those awards,
right,
came out limited in December
wide
release in January. Okay. Same thing with American Sniper, which cleaned up. So
okay,
that shouldn't be a concern at all.
But he is right. There has been no buzz about The Founder.
There hasn't been no buzz.
I get the release like that, but usually those are the ones that get the buzz, and there's no buzz on it.
But sometimes January is like a toilet bowl normally for movies, but this is not a toilet bowl movie. It's not Oscar worthy. He's great.
Right.
He's great in the movie. And you can compare it to where this is really how the face, you know, Social Network was the Facebook movie. This is the Facebook movie for McDonald's. You know, you'll never look at McDonald's the same way ever. But Michael Keaton continues to be on that role. He is on a strong stride. The guy is, he's never really lost it, but he's doing the right movies now.
He just didn't have the opportunities for a while.
Right. Yes. This is an opportunity to showcase what he's got, and he showcases it. And Offerman's great also, but this is all about Keaton. And I think that it's a fascinating movie for sure. What I like about this weekend in general is that there seems to be a movie for everyone's taste. As we just heard from Michael, who obviously goes straight to The Founder because those are his types of movies, there's something for, you know, XXX, it's an embargo, but what I can tell you is if you see the trailer and you think you know what the movie's going to be by the trailer, that's the movie. And then Split, this is more of a horror thriller than a straight up horror. And I was, this entire movie, for the most part, I liked the first quarter.
I haven't seen the movie.
I'm not ruining it.
Everybody on our staff who has seen this movie, with the exception of John Schnepp, but everybody on our staff who has seen this movie has raved about it.
Well, I'm watching
this
movie, and without spoiling anything, I'm watching this movie, and then there's something that happens. I'm like, I don't know. I'm like, this doesn't make sense why this is happening. I'm out. Then something else happens, and I'm like, wait a minute. You go back, and you rethink the entire movie. It's smart. It's a good movie, and Jeremy's right. It goes back to the old school way of Shyamalan. I would encourage everyone to see this movie. Really go and check out Split, because I want to see what Shyamalan can do next.
All right, guys, we reached that part of the show now for buy or sell. Here's how this works. In front of her, Natasha's got a few other items in the world of movie news. She's going to run them down. Then those of us at the table are simply going to say whether we buy it or sell it. So, Natasha, what do we got?
Deadline reports that Warner Brothers is in negotiations to acquire feature film rights to the Japanese manga Attack on Titan, tasking Harry Potter and Fantastic Beasts super producer David Heyman to produce. Attack on Titan takes place in a distant future where the last remnants of the human race live behind a massive wall that is built to protect survivors from skyscraper-sized monsters known as Titans. No other details have been confirmed and a release date has not been set. Kristian, buy or sell a remake of Attack on Titan?
I'll buy it. I'm curious to see how they're going to do it. I like the team that they assemble. That's usually where you're going to get my buy. When I hear those past resumes, you know, if I heard Smurfs, then I'm probably going to say no, thank you. But this is something that the premise, I like it. And Mike, I don't really know this, but I like science fiction.
Yeah, right. No, I know. so I gathered that.
This to me is a movie that I think could benefit from a remake. So I'm going to buy it.
Look, when you look at a guy like Heyman, he's produced so much big stuff and a variety of stuff. I'm going to sell this. And the only reason I'm selling it is because this wouldn't be good. I don't know that it can be done. Mm. Like, I don't know that if you look at the property, and we've got the Attack on Titan books at home, and I've seen the animated stuff, and it's ambitious, and it's big, and it's broad. I just don't know, even with where technology is today, I don't know that you could do it justice.
That's
yet.
What they said about the Star Wars.
It's true, but I just don't know that they could do this right at this point. So only because of that, I'm going to sell it. What about you, Jeremy?
I'm going to buy it. I don't know much about Attack on Titan. What I've heard is I should watch it, but no one ever tells me why. That description Natasha gave was like the best pitch I've actually gotten yet, where I'm like, oh, that sounds really cool. Okay, I should. So is this a remake, or has there been one before? Is this it an
animated,
adaptation?
It's an adaptation, yeah.
It's an adaptation, not necessarily okay. But I'm interested. But anytime they take something that's that long and crush it down to 2 hours, something's always gonna give, and a lot of times it doesn't work. But I'm interested enough from that description to be like, yeah, I'll buy it. I'll check it out.
Well, you hear Natasha describe this thing. Does it sound like something that, as a film fan, would appeal to you?
For me, it sounds like she's speaking Portuguese. For me.
Dang it.
For me, it sounds like she's speaking Portuguese. It sounds fantastic the way she speaks Portuguese. But for me, I don't know what she's talking about. I don't know. Like, you asked the question, has this been done before? Attack on Titan, Japanese manga. I mean, we're going into a whole stratosphere that doesn't resonate with me. But I know that I'm probably not the pro quo when it comes to the show here.
I love the fact that it's like, oh, so you didn't know Wolverine. What do you think of the manga?
Right, Japanese manga.
Much bigger leap.
All right, manga? Manga?
Manga.
I think manga.
Yeah, you're right.
I did it right the first time.
You nailed it.
Yeah.
All right. Oh. What's next?
Okay, Lionsgate has unveiled the first clip from John Wick Chapter 2, revealing Keanu Reeves' John Wick with a canine companion along for the ride. One half of the original directing team returns in Chad Stahelski, with the story finding the assassin once again coming out of retirement as a former associate plots to take over the International Assassins Guild. John Wick Chapter 2 also stars Lawrence Fishburne, Ruby Rose, Bridget Moynihan, and Ian McShane, and opens in theaters on February 10th. Michael, buy or sell the first clip for John Wick Chapter 2.
This is our bet. I don't think we showed this to you.
Yeah, man.
No, I'm familiar with it. I would say buy it only because I would be making a uneducated decision to say sell it. I like the cast. I like Fishburne. Obviously, Keanu Reeves, this is his milieu. So I would say we're going to buy this.
Jeremy.
Yeah, man. This clip is great because he walks into that hotel, which is it's the hotel that made this universe come alive to me. It's just like, it's this safe haven for assassins where it's like, all right, no one fights here. This is common ground here. It's like holy ground in Highlander. Like, no one can throw down there. And the fact that I'm more interested in this dog, because anytime you have that dog looks like he can actually tear a lot of people apart, and I want this dog to actually do stuff in the movie. I want this dog to be a companion for John Wick. This dog isn't going anywhere. They wouldn't do anything to this dog, I don't think, given what happened to the last one. I want to know why he's back in the game, but I love John Wick, and I'm looking forward to John Wick 2. I love this clip. I love that last shot of the dog just staring at broils from the wire. I think this is great.
I'm going to buy it. I like the clip. The clip didn't blow me away, but it's a nice little clip. I love seeing that we're back at the Continental. I want to see a spinoff movie just about that hotel, like the mythology behind it, what set up that hotel, the organization behind it. I thought that was cool. Look, I think it's fair to say that first John Wick movie was one of the most surprising movies I had ever seen. Because I think all of us just wrote it off when we heard about it. Oh, Keanu Reeves kicking the can again, huh? Well, whatever. And then we watch the movie, and that damn puppy dies. Mm. And all of a sudden, we're right with John Wick wanting bloody vengeance on anybody who would do something like that. It was brilliant the way they set it up. How are they going to do that again? Not really sure, but you can damn well bet I'm in on it. So for me, it's a huge buy.
This is a huge buy for me also because it showed so much without showing anything. And what I mean by that is when you don't, it doesn't ruin the movie because you know he's going to show up back at the hotel, but they let you know he's going back to the hotel. Mm-hmm. That was what we responded to. You're calling for a spin-off movie of it. People really responded to that because it added a little bit more layered than just a straight-up action movie. You had a part of this hotel that gave the movie character, personality. And then he walks in with the dog. The main thing everyone was talking about in the first one was, oh, they killed the dog. Go kill everybody that killed the dog. Now you see he's riding deep with the dog. Mm-hmm. And I also love the fact that you have the reaction of the calm kind of concierge, who just says, he's coming up to see you. He's back in the game. Mm-hmm. There was so much subtle. It was so subtle, the entire clip. I love that. I can't wait to see the movie.
Was the dog, like, talking stuff? What kind of dog is it? Like, a fancy dog, right? He talks. Not he reads minds.
He just chews off feet.
No, just a dog.
This is not that comic book nonsense, Michael Rapaport.
But the dog's sitting there checking into a hotel. You mean to tell me the dog is
no. John Wick, he came in with John Wick, and then John Wick told him to stay while he walked.
The dog just sits there.
Right, so he does tricks.
He flies.
Yeah, dog whisperer style, man. Caesar Milan.
I'm just checking.
All right, guys. Hey, listen. Don't forget, we do this show live every day, Monday through Friday. So if you're watching us live, we're going to save a few minutes at the end of the show to take your live Twitter questions. You can start tweeting those in right now. Just make sure you're following us on Twitter, @ColliderVideo, and fire in those questions. And Wendy will pick a couple out for us to address at the end of the show. Now, tomorrow marks the return of the Movie Trivia Schmodown. Ooh. There is a double header. Two matches are dropping tomorrow. Which ones are they? Check this out.
Inner Geekdom Champion of the World, Robert Meyer Burnett!
Team Superhero News with Adam and the little engine that choked, Hector Navarro, versus Robert Meyer Burnett and myself.
Round one, win. Round two, win. Round three,
a win.
Round four,
win.
Round five,
win.
Lunch.
W-I-N, lunch.
All I can say is hug your loved ones, close out any unsettled business you have, and then show up on Friday for your spanking kids.
The real reality is I know a bunch of stuff. I surprise myself with the stuff that I know, and I'm a pretty dang good guesser.
I am pestilence! I am the disease that will wipe these people from the face of the earth!
They call Bibiani the Beast. You're looking at the Beastmasters.
I might have pronounced this guy because he's a fluke. You're a fluke, Bibiani. You're going to fight the Duke, baby. You're getting up. I disagree!
The jungles rule the kingdom. We eat the prey. We are the lion's den.
So the game is beautiful.
All right. The crowd giving it to him here, Kristian.
Wow.
The Beast is not
he's
happy.
He's screaming at JTE.
Again, the Movie Trivia Schmodown makes its return tomorrow. It is Team Heroes with Robert Meyer Burnett, and John Schnepp is tied up this week, so he asked me to step in for him. I'll be partnering with Robert against, of course, Team Superhero News with Adam and Hector Navarro, and of course, the Beast Bibiani versus my favorite, your favorite, the People's Champion, JTE, finally with a belt over his shoulder. Make sure you check that out. I also want to remind you that a brand new episode of Awesome Tacular with Jeremy Johns drops tomorrow on the Verizon Go 90 app. Make sure you keep your eyes open for that. And of course, if you're a horror fan, the latest episode of Collider Nightmares dropped online yesterday. Go and check that out. All right, before we get to the Twitter questions, let's go to the mailbag. Natasha, what have people asked?
Joe writes, hello, Collider crew. Since Live by Night bombed, will Affleck lose negotiating power at Warner Brothers? If he wants to take the Batman in one direction and they want to take it in another, they could use the lack of success by Live by Night against him. Is this possible based on Affleck's recent comments about the movie, or is the reputation since he's done Gone Baby Gone good enough that one bomb won't hurt him in Warner Brothers' eyes? Thanks for taking my question.
This isn't going to hurt him one bit. You know why? Because it was just basically yesterday that he brought home that little trophy called the Academy Award for Best Picture and got to put it on Warner Brothers' mantle for Argo. And then, of course, it wasn't that long ago that he did The Town, and it wasn't that long ago that he did Gone Baby Gone. What Affleck has proven that he was no one-hit wonder. Look, even Spielberg had his terminal, okay? Everybody has a bad day at the office. And Live by Night is not a bad movie, but for whatever reason, whether it was the marketing or whether it was just the overall appeal of the story, it didn't appeal to the mass movie-going audience. People didn't rush out to see it. That's fine. But Affleck is still in the driver's seat when it comes to this whole thing with WB and DC. Warner Brothers knows it. He knows it. And if they ever try to give him hard time, he'll just go, okay, then I'm gone. And they go, oh, wait, we were just kidding. That's exactly what would happen at this point. So, no, I don't think Live by Night. Look, he puts out two more between now and whenever they get around to Batman, and they both do badly. That changes things. But as of right now, I don't think anything's changed. What do you think?
It's tricky. I think that he definitely has that star power. He did win the movie did win an Oscar. We're talking about Argo, of course. The thing is that I think that they're going to be more skeptical. I think that there's also there was even those rumors of when they were moving it around, the release date, because originally it was supposed to come out in wide release in December, and then they moved it to January with a limited release in December. So I think that the confidence might be shook a little bit by Warner Brothers, and maybe not even warranted, just because, you know, studios tend to do that. And we know that there's been a lot of shakeups at Warner Brothers right now, and there's been a lot of cooks in the kitchen, if you will, over there. But you've seen the frustration with Affleck and all the interviews that he's been doing recently also. So there might have been some stuff that this is a what have you done for me lately type town. So it's whether it's warranted or not. So I think that you're right, though. He could say, they're like, well, maybe we want you to do this, and then he can just say, I'm gone, because he's a big enough star that he could take off. But I still think that because it's a business and you're looking at Live by Night didn't do very well, they have a very close eye on everything that he's doing.
But let's keep this in mind, too. In a what have you done for me lately scenario, Batman versus Superman, to be fair, was divisive amongst fans.
But it made money.
But it made money. Yeah. And the one constant that people who liked the movie, like me, people who hated the movie, like many of you, will all agree on, that maybe the one saving grace of that damn thing was Ben Affleck's Batman.
Yeah.
So he is still kind of like, if he's the one tentpole that is holding this thing up, it just kind of puts even more kind of weight behind him at this point, gives him a lot more leverage. Anyway, Jeremy, do you think that Live by Night's lack of success is going to hurt Ben Affleck's positioning with Warner Brothers?
Not really. If there's anything that's going to happen, it's one of those things that's going to be so small and behind the scenes, we'll probably never even know about it. The good thing for him is that as Warner Brothers is trying to push out these DC Cinematic Universe movies, they've done Justice League. So now they've done Batman versus Superman, where he was Batman, Justice League, where he's Batman. They can't change up the Batman now, so that does give him a little bit of leeway. I mean, everyone's allowed one bad day in the office, and I mean, he's the Batman, not the Joker. That means he's not going to get flipped upside down over one bad day. He's fine.
What do you think, Michael?
I think he'll be fine. I think that Ben Affleck will be a Warner Brothers lifer, like Clint Eastwood, and you know, I don't know the minutia of Batman versus Superman. All I know is that Ben Affleck meme. But he's a very, 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 very talented director, and he's proven it. And just because of the success of the last film, I don't think it plays into it at all. And we're talking about a period gangster film versus Batman, which is like, you know, period gangster films in this day and age are niche almost as far as movies. I mean, it's very only Ben Affleck would be able to get a movie like that made. There's a handful of people that could get a movie like that made. So we're talking about they're two different. It's two different pieces of business for Warner Bros. So I don't think there's going to be any problem for him. I, you know, his directing career is going to continue to thrive and flourish for as long as I think he wants to. Because I think he really is going to be like Clint Eastwood. Like, he'll just keep going and keep going and keep going. And Clint Eastwood, some of his movies, they do well. Some of them don't do well. He's just part of Warner Brothers. That's just part of the brand.
But do you think that Warner Brothers, though, you know, because you've worked in the studio system, obviously, do you think that after you see something like Live by Night, to where it didn't do financially what they wanted to, or even get buzz, like we were talking about earlier. How do you think that the studio kind of looks at him now? Do they think,
I don't think it changes. I think you're looking at two different kinds of movies. You know, Batman has you have an audience, boom, Live by Night. It might not have generated the kind of audience you want, but it's just like they're two different kinds of things. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, sort of like McDonald's and sort of like this sort of, you know, vague noir, sort of, you know, little sushi place downtown. Everybody knows McDonald's. Not everybody's into the vague noir sushi place. Is there such thing as noir sushi?
Sure, we'll call it Horizons, or something like that.
Horizons, yeah. So I just made up a genre of films, noir sushi. There we go.
But to your point, too, like, let's take The Founder. The Founder is not going to be a big blockbuster box office.
What's The
smash.
Founder?
That's the, one
the McDonald's with Michael Keaton.
Right.
So now, if they announce tomorrow, Michael Keaton was going to be Batman again
has
in a Batman
to do with
story.
It. It has nothing to do
exactly.
with it.
Exactly. And he comes out and he's going to play Batman in his 60s versus The Founder and say,
two different
oh, well, the Founder didn't make a lot of money. Well, it's because The Founder was only ever going to make so much because of the nature of it. Whereas if he comes out and plays Batman again, the thing's going to make $800 million
worldwide. So what, they're talking about Ben Affleck directing a Batman?
Yeah he's going to be directing a Batman.
But when is this, in 5 years, 4 years? Mm-hmm.
Your guess is as good as ours. Yeah. Right?
We don't know when it's going to be. Who knows? By the time he could go away, he might be on to something else. Because he might be like, yo, I want to do another film.
Yep.
You know, so
I think
knows?
That's what they're afraid of. I think that's what they're afraid of right now.
Yeah, in a world of post-Matrix, the Wachowskis didn't lose their five-picture deal with Warner Brothers. I think Affleck should be fine. Yeah,
doesn't Affleck have something coming out with Paramount? I thought he did. Or Universal.
I wouldn't doubt it.
Directed. I thought he. I might be wrong, but I thought he had something for Paramount or Universal.
All right, guys. Listen, we want to make sure we have
Wachowski
a good amount
brothers
of time.
Are now Wachowski sisters,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. The Wachowski siblings.
What they're called, the Wachowski siblings?
That's what most people refer to them as now, the Wachowski siblings.
But when it used to be like, this film was made by the Wachowski brothers.
Yes.
What does it say now?
Wachowskis.
Yeah. Yes, actually, that is.
But they're both?
Yeah, they both.
Transsexual.
Yes.
Both of them.
Both of them did, yeah. One for a couple of years and
the
one they did.
That is the most far out shit ever. That is more far out than The Matrix. That's way out there. You never would have predicted that these guys, when they first came out as the Wachowski brothers and they made this splash as The Matrix, and now they're just the Wachowskis and they're both transsexuals. God bless them. That's fucking far out. You know, I don't care what anybody says. Two of them.
Both of them, yes.
I mean, yeah, he's a mother and a father. You got to be like, what the fuck, man? Like, this is way out there. It's fantastic they can do it and they have careers and they're great filmmakers. But, I mean, let's call a spade here. Who would have ever predicted that you have two sons that are now two girls and they're great filmmakers? It's far out. God bless them.
At some point, they're going to make a movie about it, I'm sure. Listen, we want to make sure we save some time for you guys for your live Twitter questions. So we're going to skip over the last mailbag. Wendy, what are people asking in Twitter?
So the first one comes from College Movie Man, who writes, I understand it's early in 2017, but does Split's very early release negate the chances of McAvoy's Oscar chances?
Yes.
Yeah.
No. I absolutely don't think so.
January? You think
like
January?
For next year?
You think now I'm not saying his performance. I haven't seen the movie.
No, you're agreeing
with
us.
Let's say his performance is fantastic.
You're agreeing with us right now.
Yes.
We're saying that he can't get nominated.
He ain't get nominated.
Yeah, yeah.
No way. It's just the politics of it.
It's also January.
You're not going to remember this performance in December. It looks great from the trailer, like the split personalities.
Yeah.
He ain't getting nominated.
But let me ask somebody who saw the movie. Let me ask you this.
Yes.
Take January out of it.
Yeah.
Is this good enough?
Is it this performance? A performance you go, this will be one of the top five performances of the year. It should be nominated for an Academy Award.
It's something you hope would be recognized because it is so damn good.
But do you honestly think it's going to end up being one of the top five best performances of the year?
I don't know. I don't know what else is coming out towards the end. We're going to get hit. Probably not.
But even if it's a top five best performance of the year, doesn't necessarily mean it'll be Oscar.
Right.
No, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
There's so much politics involved. And I don't think they're necessarily bad or good, but a lot of it has to do with the timing or whatever. Mm-hmm. So, but I just think a film in January like this, which is not a traditional film that you even go to for nominations, except for, you know, sets and sound and all that stuff and special effects. I just don't think you look at those kinds of films as Oscar nominations.
Although, what month did the name of the film?
10 Cloverfield Lane?
No, the one, was it Boy? The one that they shot over like 11 or 13 years?
Summertime.
Yeah, that came out.
No,
did
Boyhood,
that come,
right?
Yeah, Boy, I thought that came out around March, or did it come out later?
I felt like
it
came out in the summer.
It might have been in the summer. Okay.
Yeah.
So there goes that
point. That thing won so many Oscars.
Well, like Sing Street.
But it got nominated for a lot.
Yeah.
Sing Street was one that actually was started to get a little bit of buzz. Came out in like March or April, but I think that the time kind of hurt that too.
Yeah.
It's hard to release it that early and getting buzz.
Yeah, it's like Goodman and 10 Cloverfield Lane. It came out in March, and also it's not a movie that you would go to pick out that performance or genre, but I mean, he was one of the performances I will always remember in 2016.
Okay, yeah. Bryan Cranston's chances for Power Rangers for Best Supporting Actor?
Over under 50%.
He's in that Power Rangers movie?
Yeah. Yes.
He's the floating face.
He's the floating face.
I checked out by the time they showed
His name is Zordon, and he is the floating face.
It actually turns out it's just a blue meth.
I think it's Slim. Slim Jensen.
He plays the blue Power Ranger.
All right, what's next?
Seth John writes, what was Michael Rapaport's favorite movies of 2016?
Oh, that's a great question. So
Moonlight?
Yeah, Moonlight was great.
Loved it. The direction, the story, the sort of uncompromising, unjudgmentalness of the way that story was told, and the direction, the pacing, the trust that the director had in his story to slow things down. Great. Manchester by the Sea, I thought was great. Fences, I thought was great.
Fences was awesome.
I'm forgetting a bunch, I'm sure. But those are the three that pop into my head off the top. Denzel is so good that I don't care who he's in the scene with him. He's one of the only actors to me that you just it's hard to not watch him. It's like a gift from God. It's beyond just his talent. There's just a magnetic quality that he has. You can't take your eyes off him. All the other actors were fantastic too, but Denzel, he's like, now Fences isn't that, because I think the movie itself is really good. But he's, to me, one of the only actors that can make a bad movie very, very watchable and compelling on his own. Mm-hmm. Like, he can do that, and I think he's done it time and time again, you know, with some other films, and he's just that good. It's like a force, like a guy like an Allen Iverson in sports, where, like, yo, this guy is going to make a bad team and take it to the finals. Like, Allen Iverson took that Sixer team to the finals. Denzel is like that.
You know what movie really stands out to me that's like that for Denzel? Remember that movie he did with Chris Pine? Unstoppable,
the
one with the train.
Yeah.
I ended up really liking that movie. Take Denzel out. I'm not sure how much I like, but I loved
it. The film where he plays the bodyguard.
The one with Ryan Reynolds. Like Safe House?
No.
Oh, with the little girl.
Yep.
Burning
Girl on fire.
Girl on fire.
Not girl on fire.
Man on fire.
He makes it. He takes it to a high. You put another actor in there, you could easily go off the rails. Shout out to the late Tony Scott.
Yeah, I was going to say Tony Scott.
All right,
for
what's
sure.
next?
All right, Ethan Best writes, why is January and February the toilet bowls for movies?
Well, February's
looking good.
February's
because we
getting
got
better.
John Wick on there.
We had
do
Deadpool
have 50,
last year too.
Yeah, we do have 50 Shades, but we're going to power through that. But we still have John Wick too.
January normally, with the exception of the fact that we were just talking about before, you will see a lot of the Oscar movies hit the beginning of January because you got them in limited release in November and December, and then they hit wide release. So you take those off the table. What you do see in January normally are the low-budget, like the horror films or the bad action films, crappy comedies. And the reason why is just sometimes movies are made and the studios don't have a strong marketing budget in January. They don't want to use that money in January. They don't want to use all this money. So they don't put, they throw it in January, the lower budgets, they hope that it makes money. And they know that that's going to be the place that they just kind of dump everything, because their focus, their push is going to be in the big pushes are in the summertime, and then the big pushes for Oscar. That's where the majority of the marketing money comes, is their Oscar and their awards pushes and the summer pushes. But you get these movies. Now, we're getting into a brand new thing here, because March and April is almost becoming big budget release now, too. You look at March this year, stacked to the brim.
Right.
You've got Beauty and the Beast, Kong, Skull Island. I mean, there's so many movies coming. I think Power Rangers is another one coming out in March.
Logan.
There's so much real estate now. It's crazy.
I still think this all creates, I think, an opportunity. I still believe one of these days, a studio is going to go, you know what? people still want their movies in January. Let's try dropping a big blockbuster in January and see what happens. But the other thing, don't forget about this. We're coming off of Christmas, right? We're in a culture and a society where we spend way more money than we should at Christmas time, and they're on our loved ones, so that's fine. But I think you got a lot of people whose you know expendable cash in their pockets might be a little bit thinner than any other time of the year when you get in early January, and so that probably accounts a little bit for those smaller box offices you get in January as well. All right, let's have time for two more.
Okay, this one comes from Austin Johnson, who writes: is it possible that Wade Wilson does have a cameo in Logan, and he is the one who gives the comics to Logan?
Well, no, it's in the trailer, it looks like that's just a regular part of the world. That doesn't exist, and Deadpool pops through the door. Hey, Logan, here's a comic book. Yeah. I still don't think there's any possibility of that, but I think we're almost an ironclad lock now that Hugh Jackman will appear as Wolverine in Deadpool 2. You guys have any other thoughts?
I'm not quite ironclad about it, but like we've talked about on the show before, Deadpool doesn't fit in Logan, but Logan would fit in Deadpool. Yeah, so if they're going to do it, it would happen like that.
I agree.
All right, last question of the day.
All right, this one comes from Victor M. Another question for Michael. What movie are you most excited for in 2017?
Ooh. Man, to be honest with you, I don't even know what's coming out.
Power Rangers.
Power Rangers. Logan. Logan about the founder. The little girl. I'm not sure what's coming out yet. I'm not abreast of what's what else is coming out like later this year.
I mean, if you look, the problem is when they do the release.
Not just Star Wars.
No, I know. That's what I'm looking
at. What else you got for me, man? Yeah, that's what you got for me. I feel like it's like, you know, like what else you got for me, man?
I feel like to hit you, you'd have to go to next
Scorsese's
September,
new
right,
one.
Right.
Yeah, Scorsese's new one. There's the one he's doing with. The
Silence
next year. No, Silence came out. Oh. No, the one with the Irishman, but that comes.
But
out
they
next
say
year.
They're, but they haven't even started that yet.
That's next year.
So we don't know if that's actually going to happen.
Well, we got John Wick. You got another Pirates of the Caribbean movie.
Come on, man. Give me a fucking movie.
New Planet of the Apes.
Dunkirk
is Nolan's new movie about World War II.
Oh, right.
Yeah. Okay.
Right. See, I thought that was coming out in the fall.
No, it's coming out in the summertime.
You got Baywatch, of course. So you got to be looking forward to.
Seth Gordon. I like Seth Gordon.
Of course, the new 50 Shades we got to be looking forward to.
I'm going to see that.
Yeah. Tom Cruise is the Mummy. Baby Driver, the new Edgar Wright. That's the new Edgar Wright film. Is Baby Driver not the new Edgar Wright one? Or is that, am I thinking of The Driver?
Do you know how much money I would pay to have him review 50 Shades of whatever
it is? 50 Shades Darker?
Let's do it.
Let's, please.
You got a special screening?
You
want
to go to the screening?
What is it, 50 Shades Darker?
Yeah, that's it. Do you want to go to the screening? To see it?
We'll discuss it. We'll discuss it with the boss, Mark Fernandez. We'll go there. We'll have a screening.
If we could have Michael and Natasha review 50 Shades Darker, would be so fun.
All right.
Let's do it.
All right, guys. That'll do it for this installment of Movie Talk. Thanks so much for joining us. And don't forget, lots of great shows here on Collider Video. Make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. By the way, since they changed things up, if you're already subscribed, there's that little bell button right beside the subscribe button. Click that button. It'll just make sure you actually get notified when a new episode of Collider Video content goes online. I want to thank the people sitting at the table with me. First of all, our special guest, Mr. Michael Rapaport. Michael, thanks so much
for
being
here.
Where can people find you?
You could find me. You could just be like, yo, Mike, but I'm Michael Rapaport. On social media, I'm all Michael Rapaport. Rapaport. There's a T at the end of my name. I'm not French. Sometimes people just rap a poor, they ignore the T. There's a T, it's definitive, and it's a period. Rap a poor. For some reason they stopped that. But I'm easy to find, but I'm happy to be here, and thanks for having me back, you guys.
Of course,
I appreciate
coming, dude.
Mr. Jeremy Jahns.
You can find me on YouTube and Twitter at Jeremy Jahns and rest of the verse at Jeremy Jahns. You can also find me on the Verizon Go 90 Network with my new show, Awesome Tacular, where we talk about movies, games, TV. Have all that fun right there. Download that app, check it out, be there, because that's where the party is.
Right beside me, Mr. Kristian Harloff.
A couple things. Obviously, Collider Jedi Council, that goes up today. But we showed you before the movie Trivia Schmodown. It comes back. And I've been blown away by how many fantasy teams you guys have been creating. Go and do that. Make sure you do it. Check out the movie Trivia Schmodown Facebook page. Go and check it all out. Season starts tomorrow.
And sitting over there, of course, we've got Miss Natasha Martinez. Natasha, where can we find you?
Natasha. You guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram at @NatashaAlexis_. And I'm going to pay for us to do the 50 Shades Darker reaction. So let's do it, Michael.
Let's do it. I'm hyped about that.
And, of course, Miss Wendy Lee.
On Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, at Wendy Lee Zaney.
And you guys can simply follow me on Facebook and Twitter, at John Campea. The T on the end is silent. Thanks a lot for joining us, guys. My name is John Campea, and until next time, bye-bye.
Hey, guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.